Hare Krishna. So in today's episode, we will study the significance of Lord Krishna's birth. Because tomorrow is Janmashtami, a very auspicious appearance day of Lord Krishna. So he has actually spoken about his transcendental birth in the Bhagavad Gita, and we will take some references from Srimad Bhagavatam as well. So please repeat after me. So today's primary verse is 4.9, chapter 4, text 9. Can you all see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Think of that. Janma. Karma,
karma
cha,
cha
me,
me
divyam,
divyam
evam,
evam
yo,
yo
vetti,
vetti
tatvatah,
tatvatah.
Actually this yo is yaha. We will read from below here. Tyaktva,
tyaktva
deham,
deham
punah जन्म न एति माम एति सह अर्जुन सी सोर्जुन हिय एक्चुअली सह प्लस अर्जुन सोर्जुन सो जन्म कर्म च मे दिव्यम एवं यो वेत्ति तत्वतः त्यक्त्वा देहं पुनर्जन्म नैति मामेति सोऽर्जुन जन्म कर्म च मे दिव्यम् एवं यो वेत्ति तत्वतः त्यक्त्वा देहं पुनर्जन्म नैति मामेति सोऽर्जुन जन्म बर्थ कर्म वर्क च ऑल्सो मे ऑफ माइन दिव्यम ट्रांसेंडेंटल एवं लाइक दिस यह एनीवन हु वेत्ति नोज तत्वतः In reality, tyaktva, leaving aside, deham, this body, punaha, again, janma, birth, na, never, eti, does attain, mam, unto me, eti, does attain, sah, he, Arjuna.
Arjuna.
O Arjuna.
O Arjuna.
Translation purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Translation, one who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Arjuna. Please repeat,
one who knows
the transcendental nature
of
my appearance and activities
does not
upon leaving the body
take his birth again
in this material world
but attains my eternal abode
O Arjuna. Purport. The Lord's descent from his transcendental abode is already explained in the 6th verse. One who can understand the truth of the appearance of the personality of Godhead is already liberated from material bondage, and therefore he returns to the kingdom of God immediately after quitting this present material body. Such liberation of the living entity from material bondage is not at all easy. The impersonalists and the yogis attain liberation only after much trouble and many, many births. Even then, the liberation they achieve, merging into the impersonal Brahma Jyoti of the Lord, is only partial, and there is the risk of returning to this material world. But the devotee, simply by understanding the transcendental nature of the body and activities of the Lord, attains the abode of the Lord after ending this body and does not run the risk of returning to this material world. In the Brahma Samhita 5.33, it is stated that the Lord has many, many forms and incarnations. Advaitamachyutamanadimanantarupam. Although there are many transcendental forms of the Lord, they are still one and the same Supreme Personality of Godhead. One has to understand this fact with conviction, although it is incomprehensible to mundane scholars and empiric philosophers. As stated in the Vedas, Purusha Bodhini Upanishad, Eko Devo Nitya Leelanurakto Bhaktavyapi Hridyantaratma. The one Supreme Personality of Godhead is eternally engaged in many, many transcendental forms and relationships with His unalloyed devotees. This Vedic version is confirmed in this verse of the Gita personally by the Lord. He who accepts this truth on the strength of the authority of the Vedas and of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and who does not waste time in philosophical speculations, attains the highest perfectional stage of liberation. Simply by accepting this truth on faith, one can without a doubt attain liberation. The Vedic version, Tattvamasi, is actually applied in this case. Anyone who understands Lord Krishna to be the Supreme, or who says unto the Lord, "You are the same Supreme Brahman, the Personality of Godhead," is certainly liberated instantly, and consequently his entrance into the transcendental association of the Lord is guaranteed. In other words, such a faithful devotee of the Lord attains perfection, and this is confirmed by the following Vedic assertion. Tameva viditvati mrityumeti nanyaha pantha vidyateyanaya. One can attain the perfect stage of liberation from birth and death simply by knowing the Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and there is no other way to achieve this perfection. Shvetashvatara Upanishad, Chapter 3, Text 8. That there is no alternative means that anyone who does not understand Lord Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead is surely in the mode of ignorance, and consequently he will not attain salvation simply, so to speak, by licking the outer surface of the bottle of honey or by interpreting the Bhagavad Gita according to mundane scholarship. Such empiric philosophers may assume very important roles in the material world, but they are not necessarily eligible for liberation. Such puffed up mundane scholars have to wait for the causeless mercy of the devotee of the Lord. One should therefore cultivate Krishna consciousness with faith and knowledge, and in this way attain perfection. So, here there is a reference in the purport to the 6th verse of this chapter. So as you can see, this is 4.9, it's the 9th verse of this chapter. But from the very first verse of this chapter, Krishna has been speaking about his birth, which is very different from ours. Like, we all took birth, but we don't really study what is our, you know, unless, I mean, there are some history of famous personalities about whom we learn in the history textbooks. Like, such and such person has taken birth in this year, on this date, he has done so and so things. Like, we have in India Gandhi or Subhash Chandra Bose, and in other countries we have Mussolini, Hitler, so many. So there are studies of birth and activities of famous people. Now we should not consider the birth and activities of Krishna as one of those famous people. No, that's why the categorical description of his activities and birth are called divyam, janma karma chame divyam. Transcendental birth and activities. So what is the meaning of transcendental? What is the meaning of this? So let us see. I'll just read the translations of what exactly transpired in the 8 verses preceding this verse. So if you see here, so these are the translations of the verses. We can go into the Sanskrit, but you know, for sake of time, I'm just going to read the English. Now, fourth chapter, first verse, the Blessed Lord said, I instructed this imperishable science of yoga to the sun god, Vivasvan, and Vivasvan instructed it to Manu, the father of mankind, and Manu in turn instructed it to Ikshvaku. Now, there are many things that can be said about this verse. First of all, there is a sun planet, and there is life on the sun planet, unlike what the material scientists think, that, oh, it is so hot, nobody can live there. With our body, yes, we cannot live there, but if you have a suitable body, you can. So there they have fiery bodies, so they live in such bodies, and there is a civilization far, far more advanced than on the earth. And the king of that planet, sun god, his name is also given. Sun god or Surya Bhagavan, they say sometimes, that is a post. Like prime minister is a post, but then there is a personal name of that person who occupies that post. Like in India, there is Narendra Modi. Here there is Lee Hsien Loong. So, similarly, the sun god is named as Vivasvan. That much detail we have. And Vivasvan, and Krishna actually spoke to him. Krishna is saying that I spoke to the sun god. The same science that I am speaking to you now, Arjuna. And Vivasvan instructed it to Manu, the father of mankind. The word man comes from the word Manu in Sanskrit, or Manava. Manav or Manushya is coming because of descendants of Manu or derivatives of Manu. So the word, English word man, also comes from that. Though he is the father of mankind, or he is also called Prajapati or progenitor. In the early times of the universe, there have been these Prajapatis. According to our Vedic scriptures, we understand that there have been Prajapatis who brought forth generations of population in various species, not only the humans. So Vivasvan instructed, Krishna spoke to Vivasvan, and who is the sun god. Vivasvan instructed it to Manu, Vaivasvata Manu. Now within one day of Brahma, his time scale is different from ours. Our one day and one night is 24 hours, but Brahma's one day is unimaginable by human proportions. It's technically 8.64 billion B for billion years. So that would translate to 1000 cycles of the four yugas, Satya, Treta, Dwapara, Kali. Satya, Treta, Dwapara, Kali. Satya, Treta, like that. Just like we have months in the year, January, February, all the way to December, again January. So like that, we have four much bigger months of a yuga, I mean like months. So they are Satya, Treta, Dwapara, Kali. So here in a year, 1 month is about 30 days, plus or minus. But a yuga is differently calculated. Kali Yuga is the shortest of all the four yugas. It is 432,000 years. And the next preceding age is the Dwapara Yuga, which is 432,000 times 2, 864,000 years. And there's Treta Yuga, which is the second age, which is 432,000 times 3, which is 1,296,000 years. And finally, the Satya Yuga is 4 times the Kali Yuga's duration, which is 1,728,000 years. So if you calculate all together, you'll get 4,320,000 years, or 4.32 million years, one cycle of the four yugas. So, 1000 cycles is 4.32 million times 1000, that is 4.32 billion years. That is one day of Brahma. That means in the daytime only, not the night. So, 12 hours. The other 12 hours make up another 4.32 billion, so it's 8.64 billion years. Now, in that time frame, and Brahma lives for 100 such years, that is one day, and he lives for 100 such years. Now, in one day of Brahma, there come 14 Manus. One day of Brahma is equal to the lifetimes of 14 Manus. It means within one day, from morning to evening, one Manu comes and he is finished, and then second Manu comes, third Manu, like that, 14 Manus And the seventh Manu is our Vaivasvata Manu. Svayambhuva, Svarochisha, Uttama, Tamasa, Raivata, Chakshusha, Vaivasvata, then Savarni, Daksha Savarni, Deva Savarni, Brahma Savarni, Rudra Savarni. Like this, there are 14 Manus, names are there. So Vaivasvata is the seventh Manu. So now we are in the period of the Vaivasvata Manu. Or Vaivasvata means one who is the son of Vivasvan. Arjuna is called Partha because he is son of Pritha. Or he is called Bharata because he is son of or descendant of Bharata. Or he is called Kaunteya because he is son of Kunti. So Vaivasvata means he is son of Vivasvan. So this Manu who Krishna, I mean, the father of whom Krishna spoke to, that Manu is currently ruling the upper planetary systems and the mankind. So, Vivasvan spoke this to that Manu. And each Manu, if you calculate 14 Manus in a day of Brahma, 1000 cycles divided by 14, you will get about 71 cycles for each Manu. That means one Manu lasts for 71 cycles of the four yugas. So in for this Manu, now currently it is running the 28th cycle. And Krishna comes in every day of Brahma on the 7th Manu, 28th cycle, Dwapar Yuga, he comes. He does not come in every Dwapar Yuga. Only once in a day of Brahma. That means in 1000 cycles of the four yugas, only in one of the cycles Krishna comes as Krishna. Like as Ram, as Varaha, as Vamana, as Dattatreya, and so many, he comes, Sambhavami Yuge Yuge. But as Krishna, Sampurna Bhagavan, the original personality of Godhead, he only comes once in a day of Brahma. And that too in the 7th Manu, 28th cycle. That is his schedule. You may ask why? Why? What is so special? Well, that is his wish. He is just letting us know when he is coming, that's all. It's not that he's conforming to a rule put by somebody else, no. He's just letting us know. So now, but before he came in as Krishna, in another form, he was there on the sun planet, he's saying in this verse. And Vivasvan spoke this to his son Manu, and Manu spoke to his son Ikshvaku. I don't know if you are familiar with the history of Ramayana. Ramayana, Lord Ram comes in the Surya Vamsa, and that is this lineage. Ikshvaku was the great grandsire of the Surya Vamsa on the earth, and in that lineage Lord Ramachandra appeared, and Krishna appeared in the Chandra Vamsa. But he's not descendant of Chandra Vamsa, but he just appeared there. Now, he spoke this. Now, next verse, he says, then you may ask, okay, he spoke this to a sun god, okay, fine. What is the relevance of that information? If you speak something, there has to be some relevance, right? So what is the relevance of this conversation? He's saying that previously I spoke this, and I did not spoke something else, I spoke the same thing. But this is what happened after that. This supreme science was thus received through the chain of disciplic succession, through sampradaya or parampara system, from master to disciple, it was handed down, this knowledge, carefully. But somewhere in the course of time, the knowledge was lost. A person who is not perfect, if he hears a story, he will add his perception masala and he will tell a different story. And like that, you see the 100th person, you will have a totally different story, nothing related to the first person. So that's an imperfect person. But a perfect person who is a devotee of Krishna, I may say perfection is not possible, well, it is possible. And Arsha Vignya, such persons are called Arsha Vignya. So, Arsha Vignya Vakya Nahi Dosha Esava, Brahma Pramad Pralipsa Karana Patav. So the four defects there are that disqualify us to be propagators of true knowledge. What is that? Brahma. Tendency to commit mistakes. Pramada. Or tendency to be illusion. And Vipralipsa, cheating propensity, and Karana, part of imperfect senses. So these things disqualify us to gain any perfect knowledge from our sensory perception. Then why are we speaking here? Why am I speaking? So because this is repeated or revealed knowledge. Vedas are revealed knowledge. They are not work of any man. Not that a few sages came together, had a conference and wrote some books. No. It is directly enunciated by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And of course he incarnated as Vyasadeva and he wrote down. And even those great sages, Arshavignya, those who are actually pure devotees, they don't commit mistakes as well. They are gurus in the discipline succession, and guru's work is the most simple thing, but yet it is the most difficult thing for some reason in this material world. Guru's business is to repeat the words of Krishna without changing a single thing. Like even students who are, you know, not so well versed in studying, when they go to exam, they want to copy. They want to copy from the friends. Copying is the easiest thing to do, rather than study whole year. But of course, you can get caught and you can get disqualified. But it is easy way out, right? But Guru's business is that. He has to copy what Krishna has said. But the problem with people is, they want to be inventive, they want to be innovative. They want to be known as a creative person, a philosophical genius. They want this pratishtha. So they, what they do? Change. Tell in their own way. Distort the meaning. So these things were going on, and Krishna said, the supreme science was thus received through the chain of disciplic succession, and the saintly kings understood it in that way. But in course of time the succession was broken, and therefore the science as it is appears to be lost. So now I spoke this, but it was handed down well, but at some point in time it was lost. So now I am again coming to revive that science. That is in the next verse. That very ancient science of the relationship with the Supreme is today told by me to you, because you are my devotee as well as my friend. Therefore you can understand the transcendental mystery of this science. Rahasyam hi etad uttamam. Now there are many things important in this verse. First thing, it is that very ancient science. Krishna is not saying, well, what I spoke to Sun God, and actually if you go to the first verse in the purport, there is a calculation. If he has spoken this to Sun God, then how many years ago would he have spoken, considering the lifetime of Sun God? So the calculation comes to about 120.4 million years ago, Krishna spoke. And as when he spoke in Kurukshetra, that was about 5,100 years ago. And he spoke 120 million years ago to Sun God. That very ancient science I am telling now, Krishna said. He did not say that was outdated, that was, you know, old age for old people, you know, old fashioned people. Now modern one I will tell you, you know, so that for modern minds it will be conducive. No, that very ancient science. Real knowledge actually doesn't change. If it changes, there is not real knowledge. So, first thing is, it's the same. There's nothing changed. That's why our Bhagavad Gita is Bhagavad Gita as it is. Nothing changed. Not that, oh, Krishna spoke 5,000 years ago, no? We consider our own parents as old-fashioned. Just like 30 years ago, they were born, they were already old-fashioned for us. 5,000 years ago, what to speak. But transcendental knowledge is different from mundane knowledge. It is always true. It does not depend on time and space. It is not limited by time and space. So, first thing is the same knowledge. Next, why he chose Arjuna? Arjuna was not a very great pandit of his time. He was not known as a great pandit. He was known as a great fighter. Now, would you speak something to a fighter? You go to the boxing ring and speak Bhagavad Gita? So, and he was a king, moreover. He was not a person who was a philosopher, you know, who would think about it and, you know, like, you know. you know, marinate on it. No, he's a king, and it was not spoken in a comfortable room having some sip of tea. No, battlefield. People are going to die any moment. Armies were getting ready. In the midst of the two armies, this discussion happened. I mean, it's the most defining moment of his life. He could be killed, he could win, he could lose, and he was not wanting to fight, and he has to fight his own kinsmen. There was nothing that suggests that it was a casual conversation. And the situation did not appear like that. It was the most tense situation you can ever think of. At that time, he chose to speak this great philosophical treatise. Now, he was not a yogi, like you know, go and meditate in the forest. Nothing, not a sannyasi, not a pandit, not a brahmin, not a scholar. Why Krishna chose Arjuna? That is also, bhaktosime sakha cheti. Because you are my devotee and friend, therefore you can understand. You may be a big scholar, big pandit, big yogi, big sannyasi, but if you are not my devotee, you are a rascal, Krishna is saying. He cannot understand me. Naham prakasha sarvasya yogamaya samavritaha. What is that? Mudhoyam nabhijanati mamebhya paramabhyayam. Fools cannot understand me. So, I will not reveal myself to the fools, Krishna says, in the 7th chapter. Now here he says, I am revealing myself because you are my devotee and friend. And therefore he is, what is this? Transcendental mystery, rahasyam. The exact Sanskrit word is used here. Rahasyam hetat uttamam. I am telling you the secret because you are my friend. You will only tell your secrets to your friends, right? You won't speak some secret to somebody outside, no. Whom you trust. So, Arjuna was Krishna's friend. So that is the qualification. We have to have a friendly disposition towards Krishna. We have to accept Krishna as our friend. Bhoktaram yajna tapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhridam sarvabhutanam jnatvamam shanti mirchati. If you want peace, we have to accept Krishna in these three ways. Otherwise there is no peace. United Nations will be utter failure. Only way it will succeed is this, 5.29 of Bhagavad Gita. Bhoktaram yajna tapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhridam sarvabhutanam. These 3 points. What are they? First, a person in full consciousness of me, knowing me to be the ultimate beneficiary of all sacrifices and austerities. Krishna is the ultimate beneficiary. That means whatever we do, he should be the enjoyer of our activities. Not we should be the enjoyer of our activities or our family members or our country members. No, or our species or our race. Like those, what is that? Black lives matter. No, we are not for this. All lives matter. And life matters first of all. And human life matters the most. And life is not black or white. That is body. That is not even life. That is a dead thing. It's a totally, you know, misconstrued opinion. People, collective opinion. And there are big slogans, big movements in this way in the material world. They unite on these bodily platforms which will always be partisan based, party based. But real understanding is that I am the soul, I am not this body. So the next thing is to understand that if I am not the body, who am I? Oh, I am a servant of Krishna. Now I am thinking I am a servant of my country, of my family, of my species, of my race, whatever. Now if I understand that Krishna is actually the beneficiary, I am his servant. That is the first point. Next, we have to accept him as the supreme lord of all planets and demigods. Countries fight over a small piece of land. Because why? They think that, oh, it has to be mine. Oh, that is yours, I have to take it from you. So, that is the very thing that causes this, rift between nations or peoples. It can happen on an individual level. Mine, like, you know, children fight. Oh, this is mine, and pull each other's hair or what. So it starts from there and fight until the country level, international level, you know, whatnot. So if we understand Ishavasam Idam Sarvam, everything belongs to the Lord, then in fact that was the principle of Vedic age, you know, when people used to follow the regulative principles. So people, even though there was a strong king and the neighbor was a weak king, he would not just go, oh, he's a weak king, just finish him off. No. If he was ruling according to Vedic principles, he will not touch him. If there is some discrepancy in the other person's kingdom, if he comes to know that they're not following the Vedic principles, they're going against, then there will be war waged. Not because of power hungry, greedy rascals. No, they were Rajarshis. They were Raja, kings by profession, but Rishis by character, saints by character. So such people used to rule, but now Kali Yuga, so I don't have very good examples. So the Lord of all planets and demigods, we have to accept that Krishna is the owner, not anybody else. So he is the beneficiary, he is the enjoyer of our activities, and he is the owner, and finally, and the benefactor and well-wisher of all living entities. He is the supreme friend. Suhridam sarvabhutanam. The word suhrid is very important. Suhrid means, hrit means heart, hridam, hridayam. Suhrid means good heart. What does that mean? That means from the heart, he wishes well for us. Not just wishes, he makes every single arrangement. Even though we were rotting as a worm in the stool, he still makes our arrangement and gives us stool to eat, sitting as Paramatma. And when we are actually able to understand and assimilate his instructions in human form of life, then he leaves Bhagavad Gita. He leaves record of his pastimes. He has done so much Leela, right? He just did not do Leela and go away. No, he made sure it is recorded. So he incarnated as Vyasadeva when he... Now Bhagavad Gita, Krishna and Arjuna are speaking in the middle of the battlefield. It would have been easily lost. After that, nobody ever knows again. No, there was a record. Every single word was recorded. So he made sure whatever he was doing, he recorded and then kept it for the future. So because he wants that everyone be saved from this tribulations of birth and death, old age and disease. So he is the supreme friend. So his instructions are same as, you know, when a good friend gives you advice, you take it. So like that, we have to take his advice. Whatever he's saying in Bhagavad Gita, we have to follow. That means, that is the meaning of accepting him as his friend. Not that I will come and Krishna and I will speak to him as if he was my friend. No, that is not like that. Pure devotees can do, that's a different aspect. We have to now understand that Bhagavad Gita was spoken for us, the Leelas were written, performed for our benefit. So, associate, and he has sent, not only he came and left books, he sent acharyas time and again, so that they can explain those books to us, because even the books we cannot understand. So, all this he is doing. So, he only deals with devotees. So, the mystery was revealed to Arjuna. Then Arjuna had a doubt now. Arjuna was not simply accepting on blind faith. He was asking an interesting question. He said, wait. Arjuna said, the sun god, Vivasvan, is senior by birth to you. He understands that the sun god is 120 million years old. And you are saying you spoke to him in the beginning of his life. What are you speaking here? How am I to understand that in the beginning you instructed the science to him? Then the Lord said, many, many births, bahuni me vyatitani. Now here, we are talking about Krishna's birth, right? Janmashtami. So many, many births, Krishna said, both you and I have passed. I can remember all of them, but you cannot, O subduer of the enemy. So Krishna comes in various incarnations. He remembers every one of his lives. And every single detail of every single one of his lives. we don't even remember what we ate for breakfast. If I ask you not to look at the deity, what color dress you are wearing, you won't remember. That is our memory. Lord's memory, absolute, you know, there's no fading. Memory doesn't fade. So many births. This is the difference between his birth and our birth. One of the primary differences. He can remember everything. We cannot. We cannot remember even this birth also, many things, right? So in other words, he was saying that you, Arjuna, asking this question, you were also there with me at that time. When I was speaking this to the Sun God, you were there with me. In some capacity, I don't know which way he was there. Definitely it was not Krishna and Arjuna. Because Krishna only comes once in a day of Brahma. In another incarnation. So Arjuna also was following. Just like Nara and Narayan. Narayan is actually Krishna and Nara is Arjuna. So in which form they came, it's not specifically disclosed, but he was saying both you and I have passed many births. And Arjuna, you were also there at that time. But you don't remember it. Then he says, 4th chapter, 6th verse. We should read the Sanskrit of this because here, Ajopisan avyayatma bhutanam ishwaropisan prakritim swam adhishthaya sambhavam yatma maya. Ajaha or ajo means ajaha, unborn. Ja means janma, born. Praja means those who have taken birth in the land. Even though it may be animal, it is still considered as praja, according to Vedic understanding. Now only humans and kill the animals. Those not. So ja means janma, stands for janma. Ajaha means no birth, one who has no birth. Ajo api, although I am unborn, and my avyaya, without deterioration, our body deteriorates, right? Now here he says, although I am unborn and my transcendental body never deteriorates, and although I am the Lord of all sentient beings, I still appear in every millennium in my original transcendental form. We take many different forms, it's not our original form. But he comes, although seemingly different, sometimes like Matsya, fish, sometimes like a tortoise, sometimes like a half man, half lion, sometimes as a boar, sometimes as horse headed. Different ways he comes. But original form, Advaitam, Achyutam, Anadim, Anantarupam. So he comes in his original form, and although he is unborn, he still takes birth. This is why he is Janma Karma Chame Divyam, transcendental. He does not need to take birth. We are also unborn. We as souls, we were never born. So why we are not called Aja and, you know, big time all these titles for us? No, we fell down here. We were forced to come here because of our mistakes. Our mistake was that we wanted to be an enjoyer separate from the Lord. A separatist enjoyer. And that was our prithak bhava. That was why we came here. But Krishna comes here to save us. When the king comes into the prison to see how the prison is going on and to save those who, you know, okay, you can come out. When he goes into the prison, it's not that he is one of the prisoners. No. Just because he entered into the prison complex. No. So similarly, Krishna comes into the complex of this material world, but he is not one of us. That's why he is Janma Karma Chame Divyam. So if you go back to the next verse, he says, then he says he comes, but then why he comes? Then he gave some indications why he comes here. Because usually when we go somewhere, we have a purpose to fulfill. We don't simply go there for nothing. So Krishna says, whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharata, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. So he comes when there is this decline in religious principle. What is that? Dharmasya glani. Decline in religious principle. Then next, he says, in order to, whenever there is such a situation, I will come. And I will come and do what? Next verse. In order to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to re-establish the principles of religion, I advent myself millennium after millennium. Let's see the Sanskrit also, because these two verses are very, very important verses. summarizes the mission of the Lord. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice and a predominant rise of a religion, O descendant of Bharata, at that time I descend myself. Now if we go to the next verse. परित्राणाय साधूनां विनाशाय च दुष्कृतां धर्म संस्थापनार्थाय संभवामि युगे युगे. Three things he does. He protects the devotees when he comes here and he kills the demons, demoniac, and dharma samsthapana, establishment of religious principles. And to kill the demonic people, it's not his favorite job, and he doesn't need to come. One tsunami is enough, one earthquake, one pandemic is enough. It is said that the entire virus of the world is like 2 grams in weight, put together, 2 grams. With 2 grams you can finish millions. So he doesn't need to come to kill rascals. But why he does that? To actually protect the devotees from the rascals. And he gives confidence to the devotees. He actually only comes for devotees. And of course, for those innocent people, dharma samsthapana arthaya. Because Krishna was there on this earth for how long? 125 years. He does not want to bless only those people in that window of time. No, he wants to bless for eternity. So therefore, he does dharma samsthapana and he establishes righteous rulers like the Pandavas. He establishes scriptures like the Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. Krishne Svadhamopagate Dharma Jnanadibhissaha Kalau Nashta Drishamesha Puranarkodhanodita. So the Bhagavatam is there to continue the auspiciousness that was there on the planet when Krishna was here personally. To continue that, there is the scripture Bhagavatam. So this is how he dharma samsthapana, and he sends acharyas, his servants, to again reinforce. And he himself came. Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita, surrender to me. People do not know how to surrender. They were in fact saying, how dare he ask like this? This is too much ego. How can he ask not surrender? What is this? Who does he think he is? So they were rascals. Right? They're asking them to surrender for their benefit, they don't know. So they're challenging Krishna like that. So to show people how to even surrender to Krishna. And those who took it that, okay, Krishna said I should surrender. Okay, let me surrender. How to surrender? I don't know. So Krishna came personally as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, showed us how to surrender. Like if I can tell a child, write A, you not do how to do it. Then you take the hand of the child and then, make him write first. Taking by the hand, teaching how to move the hand. So like that, he is teaching us how to become a devotee. So he came as Bhaktavataram. Bhaktarupasvarupakam. So he came as Bhakta, Krishna Bhakta, that is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Nityananda Prabhu, they are Krishna and Balaram, but they came as Bhakta Rupa Swarupa. So, in this way, Dharma Samsthapana, he establishes religious principles. In order to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to re-establish the principles of religion, I advent myself millennium after millennium. And then comes today's verse. So if we really understand Krishna's mission, tatvataha. Is that? In truth. You see, one who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not upon leaving the world. Now when you say one who knows, if you see the Sanskrit, there is a stress. What kind of knowing? Like every Hindu knows, yeah, I have been to Janmasthan. Mathura, I have seen. That's it. That kind of knowing is not enough. Superficial knowledge. Or I know about Krishna something. He lifted Govardhan Hill, he was on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. He danced with many girls, that one they will not forget. Because they all want to do it. So, or they want to give a bad name to him. So in this way, they have some superficial, faulty knowledge of Krishna. So this is not correct. tattvataha, this stress is there. Tattvataha means in reality, in depth, in Hindi you say gharai, like in depth we have to know. So that is revealed by Krishna, and with devotion we can understand that. Without devotion, bhakto se mai sakasa. Why Krishna shows Arjuna? Because devotee. That's the key to unlock the mysteries of Krishna, understanding of Krishna. Now, if I am not a devotee, I may chant the Bhagavad Gita shlokas, I may explain it, but in my own way, and misrepresenting, misinterpreting the text. And many, many people do this. In fact, so many spiritual organizations, pseudo-spiritual organizations, there are, and they have big commentaries on Bhagavad Gita, completely separate from what Krishna is saying. And they are well-known gurus, so-called, in India, and even abroad. But they speak nothing of what Krishna actually speaks. So, tattvataha, in reality, if we know, then tyaktva deham punarjanmanaiti, then there is no more rebirth for us. If we understand his birth, then our birth will be stopped. If you learn about birth of Gandhi or birth of Hitler, our birth will not stop. We will continue. But if we learn about Krishna's birth, our birth will be stopped. No more rebirth. Now, I want to take... Wow, 8:40. Okay. I'll take you to this few verses from the Bhagavatam, where Kunti Devi, the mother of the Pandavas, she also spoke about the Krishna's Janma. Now it starts here, 1829. She says, Na veda kasche bhagavam shchikirshitam tave hamanasya nirnam vidambanam Nayasya kaschid dayitosti karhichid dveshyascha yasmin vishamamatir nirnam. O Lord, no one can understand your transcendental pastimes. Krishna says, oh, if anybody can understand, he can come back to me. She is saying nobody can understand. Which appear to be human and so are misleading. Avajananti mam mudha. Shri Shri Radha. Avajanti Mamudha Manushim Dhanumashritam. When he comes in amongst humans, we mistake him for an ordinary human and we dare to criticize. People dare to criticize him or give their opinion about him. Who are they? Insignificant specks of dust in this material world, and he is the owner of everything. So she is saying, when you come here, nobody can understand your pastime. And they are very misleading. You have no specific object of favour, nor do you have any object of envy. People only imagine that you are partial. It is like this. It always, of course, appears that Krishna is partial to his devotees. But actually, he is equally disposed to everyone. But the devotees make themselves suitable receptacles of his mercy. That's all. Like when it's raining, I can harvest the rainwater by putting some tank, or I can just let it go on the ground and I don't have anything to drink. Of course, there is a natural process, but I can harvest something, right? Or when there is sun, or when there is moon, there is a Bengali proverb. It's nicely stated that the moon shine or the moon does not choose not to shine on a chandala. It will not say that, okay, I am moon, I will only put the spotlight or limelight on the brahmana. Chandala, no, put him in the dark. No, moonlight is the same for everyone. But it's my thing. I can come into the moonlight and you know, see it, or I can just hide away and say there is no moonlight. You know, moon doesn't like me. You know, is not putting any light on me. I can say anything, but who is to be blamed there? Moon is not to be blamed. If I enclose myself in a room, then who can do anything? So that is the difference. It is that the devotees voluntarily become recipients of Krishna's mercy, whereas the non-devotees choose not to. So otherwise he's not partial. Now next. Now human pastimes are misleading. Next thing she says is this. Janma karma. Krishna says janma karma cha me divyam. She says janma karma cha vishvatman ajasya akarturatmanaha. Ajasya means janma, means birth. Ajasya means there is no birth. Akartur, who has nothing to do actually. Kartu means to do. Akartu means he has nothing to do. But still he comes. Janma karma, birth and activities of a person who has nothing to do and who is unborn. You know, if I have nothing to do, I will not do it. I am doing something because I need to do it, to achieve something. But he does not need to achieve anything. He's already, he's self-sufficient. What he needs to achieve? Why should he endeavor? There is no reason. Such activity can only come from the platform of mercy, daya. Like a rich man, when he goes out to do some charitable business, he wants to help. Of course, some people want name and fame, that's something. We're talking about somebody who really wants to help. So he wants to help the people. So he is acting, but he does not need to get anything from that. He is helping the others. But of course, that help is also, if you just help the body, that's not going to be anything. Not going to be much help. Helping the soul is the real help. Then that means preaching Krishna consciousness. That is the real welfare activity. Anyway, that's about janma karma cha vishvatman ajasya akarturatmanaham tiryan. Tiryan means, tiryak means subhuman. Below human species also you have come. Human species, your incarnation among human beings already bewildering, difficult to understand, nobody can understand. You are coming even in the animal species. Tiryan, nir means human, rishishu, as a sage, you know, like Naranarayan, rishi. And there is also the Parashuram, and also Vamanadev, who came as a Brahmin. Rishishu, yadahasu means aquatic. Tad atyanta vidambanam. Atyanta means very much bewildering. The previous verse vidambanam is there. Here atyanta vidambanam. Your birth, you know, Krishna's birth. Of course it is bewildering, O soul of the universe, that you work though you are inactive, and that you take birth though you are the vital force and the unborn. You yourself descend among animals, men, sages and aquatics. This is very bewildering. And then she mentions one of the activities of Krishna, which is again another very bewildering. And because she is, you know, a woman and has a motherly affection for Krishna, she gave this example of the Mother Yashoda.
Gopyadade tvayi kritagasidamatavad yate dashashru kalilanjana sambhramaksham vaktram niniyabhaya bhavanaya sthitasya Samam vimoha yati bhi api yat bibheti.
My dear Krishna, Yashoda took up a rope to bind you when you committed an offense, and your perturbed eyes overflooded with tears, which washed the mascara from your eyes, and you were afraid, though fear personified is afraid of you. This sight is bewildering to me. One of the karma, janma karma, right? One of the karma she mentioned, something that relates to her. She also has a motherly affection. And then she goes on, 1, 2, 3, 4, 32, 33, 34, 4 verses, giving many, many reasons of why Krishna appears. Let's look at them. 1832.
Kechidahura jamjatam punya shlokasya kirtaye. Yado priyasyanvavaye malayasyeva chandanam.
Some say that the unborn has taken birth for the glorification of the great pious king. Who is that? King Yadu. That's why he is called Yadav. He is known as Yadav. Everybody knows Krishna is known as Yadav. By that name, King Yadu is glorified. So to glorify his devotees, he comes in their dynasty. Just to give them glorification. One of your dearest devotees, King Yadu, and others say that you took birth to please King Yadu. Ugrasena also was a great king, in the same as a grandfather. Now, you appeared in his family as sandalwood appears in the Malaya hills. In Malaysia, actually, previously it was full of sandalwood. But now it's all palm oil. Before it was sandalwood, it was famous for sandalwood. So, Malayasyeva Chandanam, you know, like we say Kohinoor diamond, you know, from Kohinoor. So, like that, you know, it's for something else, another thing which is associated with it gets importance, you know. So, like that. So, like Mathura. He was born there, and therefore Mathura is. So, the glory of Mathura is because of being related with Krishna. Similarly, devotees. So, he comes in a family of devotees to glorify them. Just like sandalwood will be known as Malaya Seva Chandanam. Oh, this is sandalwood from the Malaya tree, or Malaya hills. That's why our farm project, we call this Malaya Giri Dham. That's why Prabhu Sindhu Prabhu chose that name because of this verse. Malaya Giri Dham. So, that is one reason, to glorify his devotees.
Apareva sudevasya devakyam yachitobhyagatajastvamasya kshemaya vadhaya cha suradvisham.
Actually, the topic of Krishna's birth is so expansive, we cannot finish in the session. But we are just touching the very little surface of it. So much to be spoken actually. So this is another reason now. Others say that since both Vasudeva and Devaki prayed for you in their previous life, Sutapa and Krishni, they did austerities for 12,000 years of the Devatas, which translates to 12,000 times 365 years in our calculation. That long they did very, very intense tapasya, austerity, to get the Lord as their son. So three times the Lord came as their son, and this is one of those. So Vasudeva and Devaki prayed for you, and you have taken your birth as their son. Undoubtedly you are unborn, yet you took your birth for their welfare and also to kill those who are envious of the demigods or the suras, devotees. That is another reason why you came. Next, 1834.
Bharavataranayanyem bhuvonava ivodadhau sidantya bhuribharena jatohyatma bhuvarthitaha.
Others say that the world, being overburdened like a boat at sea, was much aggrieved, and that Brahma, who is your son, prayed for you, and so you have appeared in order to diminish the trouble. Actually, this was the history. Just before Krishna's birth, Mother Earth goes in the form, takes the form of a cow and goes to Lord Brahma and tells that, I am being overburdened by unscrupulous kings. Please do something to reduce my burden. So then Brahma goes to the shore of the milk ocean and chants the Purusha Sukta mantras, invoking the Lord. And then the Lord answered the prayers of Brahma, and he spoke to him that, yes, you ask all the demigods, all the devatas to take birth on the earth as my family, you know, my predecessors or somebody, and then I will come. So he made all the arrangements of different demigods, took different roles on the earth, and they participated in this Leela. And then Krishna came. So this is one of the reasons. Then next.
Bhavesmin klishyamananam avidya kama karma bhihim shravanasmaran arhani karishyan nitikechana.
And yet others say that you appeared in order to renovate the devotional service of hearing, remembering, worshipping and so on, in order that the conditioned soul suffering from material pangs might take advantage and gain liberation. Because, next verse,
Shrinvanti gayanti grinantya bhikshnashah smaranti nandanti tave hitam janah तएव पश्यन्त्यचिरेण तावकं भवप्रवाहो परमं पदाम्बुजम्.
O Krishna, those who continuously hear, chant and repeat your transcendental activities or take pleasure in others doing so, certainly see your lotus feet, which alone can stop the repetition of birth and death. So in order for this to happen, you have come. So in this way, she has come up with so many reasons, but actually all of them are correct. It's not that some say this, some say that, everybody will have argument and fight. No, all are correct. He fulfills all these things. And in the last verse of her prayers, she summarizes all these things. And if you see this verse, a beautiful verse.
Shri Krishna Krishna Sakhavrishni Rishabhavani Dhru Rajanyavam Chadahanana Pavargavirya Govinda Godvija Surarti Haravatara Yogeshwara Akhila Guru Bhagavan Namaste.
All are mentioned here in this one verse. O Krishna, O friend of Arjuna. He can't enter anymore. He locked the door. O Krishna, can somebody open it? Open it for him before he knocks. Oh yes. O Krishna, O friend of Arjuna, O chief amongst the descendants of Rishni. You are the destroyer of those political parties which are disturbing elements on this earth. Your prowess never deteriorates. You are the proprietor of the transcendental abode and you descend to relieve the distresses of Govinda Godvija Surarthi Haravatar. Relieve the distresses of the cows, the brahmanas and the devotees. Govinda Godvija Sura. Arthi means the distress. Hara means avatara. Hara means destroyed. One who destroys the arthi or the distresses of Govinda Godvija Surarthi Haravatara. Yogeshwara Akhila Guru Namak. Akhila Guru. He is the Jagat Guru. You possess all mystic powers and you are the preceptor of the entire universe. You are the Almighty God and I offer you my respectful obeisances. So these are some of the reasons. And one little detail, important detail I would like to. There is so much more to do. In the 10th canto, and what was that verse? The six sons of Devaki and all that? We spoke about in the Balaram Janta? 10 to 8. Okay, thank you. Krishna was born not by sexual union. I mean, he came as result of sexual union also when he wanted to, but in the case of Krishna, he did not. So here it is said, 10th canto, 2nd chapter, 18th verse. Tato jaganmangalam achyutamsham. Jaganmangalam. All words are very important. Tato jaganmangalam achyutamsham samahitam shurasutena devi dadhara sarvatmakam atmabhutam kashtha yathanandakaram manastah. Okay. Thereafter, accompanied by plenary expansions, the fully opulent Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is all auspicious for the entire universe, was transferred from the mind of Vasudev to the mind of Devaki. From the mind of Vasudev to the mind of Devaki. Devaki, having thus been initiated by Vasudev, became beautiful by carrying Lord Krishna, the original consciousness for everyone, the cause of all causes, within the core of her heart, just as the east becomes beautiful by carrying the rising moon. So, she was practically initiated by Vasudev. So it was different from ordinary pregnancy. So the important thing here is that actually Devaki is signifying the devotee. And let's look at that analogy by Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur. 10 to 8 of Srimad Bhagavatam. देवक्या जठरे गर्भम शेषाख्यम धाममामकम तत् सन्निकृष्य रोहिण्या उदरे सन्निवेशया. Within the womb of Devaki is my partial planetary expansion known as Sankarshan or Sesha. Without difficulty, transfer him into the womb of Rohini. This was the, when Balaram came. So here, in this connection, one may ask how the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is always situated transcendentally, could enter the womb of Devaki, which had previously been entered by the six Asuras, the Shadgarbhas. Does this mean that the Shadgarbhasuras were equal to the transcendental body of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? Now, before Krishna was born, six sons of Devaki, they were born and then they were killed straight away. Now, what was the history of those six sons? They were actually Asuras in their previous life. And they also signify a very important thing. The following answer is given by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. The entire creation as well as its individual parts is an expansion of the energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, even though the Lord enters the material world, He does not do so. This is explained by the Lord Himself in Bhagavad Gita, Maya Tatamidam Sarvam, Jagadavyakta Murtina, Matsthani Sarva Bhutani Nachaham Teshvavasthitaha, Nachamatsthani Bhutani Pashyame Yogamaishwaram, Bhuta Bhrinnacha Bhutastho, Mamatma Bhuta Bhavana. By me in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them, and yet everything that is created does not rest in me. Behold my mystic opulence. Although I am the maintainer of all living entities and although I am everywhere, I am not part of this cosmic manifestation, for myself is the very source of creation. Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma. Everything is an expansion of Brahman, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, yet everything is not the Supreme Godhead and He is not everywhere. Everything rests upon Him and yet does not rest upon Him. This can be explained only through the Achintya Bheda Bheda philosophy. Such truths cannot be understood, however, unless one is a pure devotee. For the Lord says in Bhagavad Gita, Bhaktyamam Abhijanati Yavanyaschasmitatpataha. One can understand the Supreme Personality as He is only by devotional service. Even though the Lord cannot be understood by ordinary persons, this principle should be understood from the statements of the Shastras. Now, this is what His explanation was, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Symbolically, Mother Devaki's constant fear of Kamsa was purifying her. Yatharishikesha khalena Devaki Kamsena ruddhati chiram sucharpita. Kunti Devi actually said in the 1.8.23. So, Mother Devaki's constant fear of Kamsa was purifying her. A pure devotee should always fear material association. And in this way, all the asuras of material association will be killed, as the Shadgarbhasuras were killed by Kamsa. It is said that from the mind, Marichi appears. In other words, Marichi is an incarnation of the mind. Marichi has six sons: Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya, lust, anger, greed, illusion, madness, and envy. These are the six sons of the Devaki. Symbolically, they represent these six. And if a devotee, represented by Devaki, is always alert, fearful of material association like Kamsa, then these six things can be killed. The Supreme Personality of Godhead appears in pure devotional service. This is confirmed in the Vedas, Bhakti Revainam Darshayati. Only Bhakti can bring one in contact with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared from the womb of Devaki, and therefore Devaki symbolically represents Bhakti. And Kamsa symbolically represents material fear. When a pure devotee always fears material association, his real position of bhakti is manifested and he naturally becomes uninterested in material enjoyment. When the six sons of Marichi are killed by such fear and one is freed from material contamination, within the womb of bhakti, the Supreme Personality of Godhead appears. Thus, the seventh pregnancy of Devaki signifies the appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which is Balaram. And then Balaram purified the womb and then Krishna entered. It was not like a glitch in the plan of Krishna that Balaram already went inside. Hey, move him. I need to come. My time has come. No. There was a reason. Nothing happens like that. Oh, something mistake. No. Krishna doesn't know. So Balaram went there, purified. Similarly, our life. Now we have all these anarthas. So by stake, that's why we chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. This Rama is referring to Balaram. We are begging for spiritual strength from Balaram so that Krishna can manifest in our hearts. So we need to be purified, we need to be strengthened by devotional service, and all our anarthas have to go, have to be killed, like the six sons of Devaki. And for that to happen, she was fearful of Kamsa. We have to be fearful of Maya. That means we have to be alert. That is also explained here. After the six sons, Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada and Matsarya are killed, the Shesha incarnation creates a suitable situation for the appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In other words, when one awakens his natural Krishna consciousness, Lord Krishna appears. This is the explanation given by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. So this is the explanation of Krishna's birth and how it connects to our life also. It's one of the many things we can learn from his birth also. Like this, there are so many details which cannot be completed in this session. So you can read the birth of Krishna in the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam. So we can understand like this, that this is called Tattvataha. When we say, we have to understand Janma Karma evam Tattvataha Vetti. That's why it is said, Kiba Vipra, Kiba Nyasi Shudra Kene Noi, Jai Krishna Tattva Vetta, Shai Guru Hoya. So Guru is a person who knows Krishna Tattva. And Krishna Tattva means like this, Janma Karma in depth. So this is how we have to understand. So we can learn more and more from Srila Prabhupada's books. And there's so much information. So this is just a gist. So we'll stop here. Anybody has any questions? Any doubts? I don't know if there's anything on the internet. There is one, what is this? Krishna and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu come in every Dwapara and Kali Yuga. Not only in the 28th Chaturyuga, but the reference is that in the rest of Chaturyuga, they come through Kshiradagasaya Vishnu, not directly. Well, we need more information on this. It is not mentioned like that. At the end of Dwapara Yuga of the 28th Divya Yuga, Lord Krishna appears on earth with the full paraphernalia of his eternal Vrajadham. First, Lord Krishna appears at the close of the Dwapara Yuga of the 28th Divya Yuga, and then Lord Chaitanya appears in the Kali Yuga of the same Divya Yuga. Krishna and Lord Chaitanya appear once in each day of Brahma, or once in 14 Manvantara avatars, Manvantaras, each of 71 Divya Yugas in Varish. So here it says he comes once. How is he saying that he is coming every Dwapara and Kali? Through Kshiradagasaya Vishnu, something he's saying. Well, it's different here, differently mentioned. He says it is not the original one. Krishna comes through. Actually, here also it is said that he comes through Kshiradagasaya Vishnu. All the incarnation expansions merge in him when he comes. Anyway, you have to take what here is mentioned. So, alright, we have any more questions?